I have my trajectory in the U.S. started as a graduate student at Brown University. I got my PhD there on humanities, Spanish department, and women's studies. And then I had my first academic position at Lawrence University. That's where I met Helen a long time ago. Yeah. In Appleton, Wisconsin. And then I moved to Houston, University of Houston, for a more specialized position, more research-oriented position on early modern Spanish literature, women's, feminist literature of that period. And then I decided to change my life and move back to Spain and started doing other kinds of work related to feminism and activism. Like I was mentioning there, like, or one of the big things that I've done these years before Women's Knowledge International is precisely to bring to Spain the Women's World Conference, which congregates around 4,000 people, activists and academics from around the world. And that was in 2008. And ever since, because that conference had changed my life, really, and brought to me a very huge perspective on contemporary issues that I brought into my own work, my own recent research, which is what I'm going to talk to you about. And it has a lot to do with the work that I came to do at UW this month, and the work that I'm doing with Araceli and Kate Austin, preparing a manual of best practices on some of the things that I'm going to tell you today. So thank you very much for coming. I'm really excited about sharing this recent work with you. I'm very excited about getting your feedback too. So don't worry if you can't follow me at some point, you know, because I believe that I'm aware that the things that I'm going to tell you may not click immediately, but I'm going to go back and back and back until the end of the presentation. I hope you get the idea more clearly at the end. And I'm going to read it the old-fashioned way, no PowerPoint, nothing, on purpose, because I want you to listen carefully to what I'm saying and not get distracted with the PowerPoint that sometimes is more a distraction than really a support. So I'm starting. And I'm going to read it so because Spanish, you know, is not my first language, so I feel more, yeah. Can you hear? Okay, I will try to project the voice. But this presentation departs from a long-time scholarly conviction of mine that feminism is everywhere and that every woman is, to some extent, a feminist. I am aware that this universalizing assertion needs much clarification. I do not expect to cover the extent and depth of analysis that this requires. Instead, to support my position, I will propose a reconceptualization of feminism as a component of affect, a non-reasoning conscious phenomenon located in emotionality. An emotional type of feminism that I will refer to as feminist emotion. My ultimate purpose is to convey to you the strong message that the concept of feminist emotion can be very useful for feminist analysis, but also for politics. I claim that there is an instrumental value to it because it speaks of the specific constituencies of rebelliousness located in many emotions in the context of patriarchal settings. In this sense, my approach to feminism seeks, above all, a pragmatic twist founded on the assumption that the realm of emotions is much more accessible to everyone than rational engagement. To begin with, we should explore ways to foster what neuroscientists call the attunement of the individual to the interpretative value of emotions. Criticism on emotions and feminism is quite vast, starting with pioneers like Alison Jagar or Carol Gilligan, whose analysis deeply questioned rationalist views to revalue emotions and dichotomous categorizations of cognition versus affect. Jagger argued for the need to pay attention to what she called outlaw emotions, emotions that do not support norms and values. Gilligan, among other things, demonstrated that the importance of care and relationships in the moral development of women, and claimed that society should value it. Most recently, there are new and numerous exciting proposals. On the one hand, neuroscientific discoveries in psychology have completely dismantled the notion that affect and cognition are two separate things. For instance, the work of various neuroscientists, like your colleague, Professor Richard Davidson, with whom I had a very good discussion here at UW on April 18th about my concept of feminist emotion, has demonstrated that emotions are located in the same brain spot than rational cognition, that our DNA dispositions are located in, that our DNA dispositions are by no means determinant of our behavior and unchangeable, that positive emotions can be fostered and our emotional styles, because there are five emotional styles, reshaped, that we very much learn by affective imitation through the existence of mirror neurons and so on and so on. On the other hand, cultural studies, affect theorists like Brian Masumi and Sarah Ahmed or Teresa Brennan, from a feminist standpoint, these last two names, have persuasively proposed that affect is a bodily independent force, always in motion, that shapes the social and of which the individual has no control. Thus, according to these critics, affect is transmitted in multiple ways beyond the individual, the subject, and beyond representation. Masumi, for instance, Ryan Masumi, makes a distinction between feelings, emotions, and affect. Feelings are, for him, personal, subject to the person's interpretation. Emotions are social, a projection or display of a feeling into the world. That is what makes feelings feel. An affect, for him, is a pre-personal and non-conscious experience of intensity, a moment of unformed and unstructured potential. This is not by any means the only definition of affect, nor the one that I fully subscribe for my thesis. There are recent social psychological proposals that increasingly argue for a broader notion of affect to encompass emotions too. In general, current debates outline the relational and dynamic nature of affect, as well as its fragmented manifestations through complex patterns that it draws in the individual, social, and cultural communal domains. The common thread to all these new proposals in the humanities and the social sciences is that the biological and the cultural nature of affect are closer and closer together, and that affect is both historically situated and dynamic. In other words, it permanently shifts in relation to power relations. My work is informed by these current debates, and it is in tune with a recurrent claim on the importance of affect as a regulatory element of the social. My early scholarly research on Spanish early modern women's literature a few years ago led me to the conviction that feminism was an ever-present narrative, a prevalent undercurrent that ran across the literature of the time and was written out masterfully, disguised with twists and turns of the literary conventions, largely through discourses of on affect as related, for instance, to romantic love. I conceptually capture the notion of prevalent and pervasive feminism in literature with the term stealthy rebellions, and structure my thesis around it with the, by then, still in the making concept of feminist emotion as a prevalent force behind those stealthy rebellions. I argue that feminist emotion triggered discursive utterances that could be interpreted and as representations of the non-male subject's rebelliousness. Over the years, I have come up with a reinforced assumption that there is much happening in real life, not just in literary texts, before gender experiences are mediated, interrogated, or interpreted by cognitive rationality. To guide you through my most recent research work, let me catch your attention on two core reflections that underline my presentation, my work. Now, one, that in patriarchal settings, women maintain agency intact, at least at the emotional level. And two, that women are constantly writing themselves out of, emancipating from, normative meaning on gender-related intersectionalities through affect, regardless of their degree of consciousness about it. To begin with, I propose a phenomenological approach to emotions as posed by critics like Norman Denzin in his book on Understanding Emotion, in order to capture the specificities of experience, avoid and revise universalism, and get closer to a type of meaning entrenched in emotionality that is elusive by its very emotional nature. The type of emotional agency that I am seeking to capture under the term and concept of feminist emotion manifests through a wide range of variations and nuances of emotion as rooted at the empirical level of socialization. It is dispersed throughout fluctuating non-reasoning conscious processes, non-reasoning consciousness. But I am not so much interested in emotions as a psychological state. What I am pursuing is the political relevance of retrieving, identifying, and fostering some kind of attunement of women to their own primary forms of agency as they are rooted in emotionality. That is, a feminist affective force contained in the infinitely diverse phenomena of gender experience. Feminist emotion is a component of emotions that contain and make meaning about the person's affective resistance to contextually situated gender prescriptions and norms, as they intersect with many factors and many circumstances. In this sense, a second anchor to my proposal is an intersectional approach. People are mobilized by a wide range of diverse repertoires of affective practices, very closely linked to context. Also, affective repertoires coexist with very local and transient affect. In other words, when looked at closely in a relational way, emotions are much more complicated and clustered than we traditionally believe and try to capture as fear, anger, shame, joy, rage, etc. Or even as automatic physical responses and non-intentional sensations, like affect theorists claim. This is why emotions can be very better grasped with the concept of affect as containing numerous components dynamically integrated, including feminist emotion. One of these components is precisely what I call feminist emotion, and it is located in emotionality to the extent that it directly emanates from experiences strongly marked by gender, in conjunction to many other factors, of course. So, what do we expect to find when examining affect in search of this component, feminist emotion? The answer for now is that we will find meaning. Meaning about what? Meaning about the untamed capacity for epistemological emancipation in spite of and within the affective messiness of social life for non-male beings within patriarchal epistemologies. And I'll go on over this again. Meaning, again, about pervasive subversion and agency. The next problem we are confronted with is interpretation. How do we interpret affect? According to a phenomenological approach, epistemologically speaking, emotionality is unstable. Its non-fixity of meaning, its non-stickiness, applies to the individual in relation to herself, as well as to her relational encounters with emotional associates. But the good news is, and this is why we need a concept like feminist emotion, hope to convince you throughout this presentation, that precisely the non-fixity of meaning is what makes emotionality unavoidable as a meaning-making force. And the notion of unavoidable emotionality, in my opinion, opens up the door to its political significance for political purposes, for feminism. In a compelling analysis of will in the context of institutional diversity politics, affect feminist theorist Sarah Amen states that willfulness is, in her own words, quote, a refusal to look away from what has been already looked over, end of quote. Gender is a condition that, together with other factors, prescribes women to be looked over. But there is also, this is my take on it, a permanent and inevitable refusal to be disregarded that takes place at diverse levels of consciousness, including non-consciousness. Along the lines of Ahmed, we may say that perseverance and persistence, going with the flow, even silence, and just physical proximity, can be undetected ways in which women express or behave or express willfulness. Although by no means they are the only ones, neither the only effective ones. The issue at stake, the point I want to make, is that diverse ways of making willfulness undetected may hold strong political significance. However, in my view, such significance is diluted if we do not look at it as prompted by a rather autonomous primary form of agency, not just as a subtle behavior, unintentional behavior. According to my view, feminist emotion would be a personal and collective good that is permanently circulating before it is identified and or used as communicable or preemptive affect. But it cannot be separated, I believe, contrary to what affect theorists claim, from the personal and the phenomenological realms. There is much to reflect around willfulness and autonomy as they relate to agency and emotions. As you well know, Western liberal philosophical stance, in Western liberal philosophical stance, agency is generally understood as individual liberty and a precondition for desired autonomy to emerge. That is, as a primary capacity to rebel against all that impedes independent control over one's life. Reach a desired degree of well-being, become a leader, freely express willfulness, and or be empowered as a person in this world. In the field of development studies, the work of Amartya Sen and Martha Nussbaum are keystone on the catalyst idea that the degree of agency someone enjoys determines her possibilities for success in achieving a full human life. In other words, in living to the highest degree of her potential as human. I believe that a no-return path for feminist criticism and praxis was prompted by the capabilities approach because of its shift to place individual capacities at the center of politics instead of just rights. My fundamental objection to this approach is that it sets an a prioristic limit to the very idea of agency because it ignores that there is already agency before favorable circumstances are in place. As Miranda Fricker points out in a recent study, women are subject to generalized hermeneutical injustice that often makes it very difficult for them to understand the mechanisms of oppression. However, I believe it is important to take into consideration that there is also pervasive meaning in emotionality about overcoming such disadvantages, hermeneutics and socializations. But how do we foster women's individual and collective awareness or attunement to such knowing of their own emotionality? I am aware that the political value of what I call feminist emotion lies in its very possibilities to be recognized, interpreted also, endorsed, and passed on as effective collective practice of women's agency. In other words, our tasks as feminists may be first to acknowledge that there is a primary form of agency, a component of affective pervasive rebelliousness, and second, to design ways in which such primary form of agency can be turned into a skillful agency. And this is one of the points that I discussed with Richard Davidson, and we agreed on this, and it was very exciting. As you may already be anticipating, a great challenge for feminist politics that relay on what occurs in emotionality to some degree is the paradoxical nature of the experience of gender in a patriarchal setting. That is, as emotions and affective manifestations resulting from external hardships take over in the individual woman, or non-male, if you prefer, the harder it may become for the individual person, woman, in this case non-male, to point at gender prescriptions as related to her ills. The more anew that being is. But this challenge is no different, this is my point, is not different from what feminist critics and activists have to face when they focus on the rise of feminist consciousness as the best means to foster traditionally understood forms of agency. I believe that, in fact, emotionality could be the means to work around the traditional challenge of feminist politics, this traditional challenge. The main reason is that the potentially disruptive quality of emotions in a preconscious selection is a preconscious selection mechanism of what is right and what is wrong. And that it takes place when gender is experienced in a patriarchal setting. One of the goals endlessly pursued by feminists is to promote autonomy and foster diverse forms of women's emancipation. My view on emotionality as agency is based on the value of procedural self-definition and autonomy acquisition, highly mediated by context and historically situated. I am aligning with claims around the utmost relevance of experiential knowledge and qualitative approaches, such as those pushed forth compellingly by feminists like and theorists like Lorraine Quote and Sandra Harding. I believe that it is necessary to authoritatively situate or resituate the epistemic value of emotions derived from gender experiences by moving away from the so-called objective thinking so deeply questioned by these feminists and many others. In fact, even just a certain degree of awareness of one's own emotionality may be the path to certain forms of autonomy. Autonomous theorists like Catriona Mackenzie and Diana Meyers have addressed autonomy in relational terms, that is, as the process of interaction between the agent and various motivational structures. But the issue at stake is how autonomy and agency are to be achieved and even defined. Throughout her life span, an individual woman, and again, it could be non-male, you know, this is an expression of an individual woman will experience diverse forms of emancipation, autonomy, or oppression wrapped up in clustered emotionality, because a gender rebellious force lurks her emotions. Thus, critical positions suitable to grasp gender-induced rebelliousness should situate themselves at the epicenter of emotionality shifting instances, the patterns that affect drops, and so on. In other words, issues of emancipation, autonomy, and even agency are just as much better captured and defined, in my opinion, through unstable conceptualizations. Let us examine a veritable case study that, in my view, can be very productively analyzed through the lenses of feminist emotion. If you are a little sleepy, this will wake you up. If you have lost track of it. We all have arrived at the critical point of my proposal. The difficulty of bringing about the notion of concealed primary agency, what I call feminist emotion, for the political aim of fostering well-being and emancipation in the real world. But the first step is to analyze what happens in the real world in such a way that important meaning is not overlooked or wasted for political purposes and agendas. A workshop on domestic violence took place not long ago in the district of Kwale, a rural region of Southeast Kenya. It was part of a highly successful and United Nations acclaimed and awarded comprehensive program on gender, health, well-being, and sustainable development, implemented, carried out by the organization Nikumbuki Health My Motorbike, an organization founded and directed by your colleague, Professor Araceli Alonso. As I describe the workshop session, please keep in mind three relevant questions that are related to my analysis of the workshop that will follow. The three questions are, one, how does affect circulate during the session? Two, how does it solidify? In other words, what traces or prints does it leave as it emerges? And most important, three, how does circulation of affect and its patterns of solidification relate to the interpersonal, communal, and individual histories and stories that are told during the workshop? So here's the description of the workshop session held by Professor Alonso and some UW students. Bear in mind that I have omitted names and details to preserve the privacy of the participants, etc. 20 women and one man of different ethnic groups, the Maasai, Digo, Akamba, and Duruma, participate in a workshop on domestic violence for community health promoters. The session starts with a short theater sketch of a husband and wife in daily interaction at mealtime, during which he becomes verbally and physically aggressive gradually for trivial matters. Following the sketch, participants are asked to draw and write examples of their own experiences with domestic violence as victims or witnesses. The time to share the drawings and annotations comes. One woman speaks of her husband controlling the money. Others speak of clitoris cutting, girls given as debt payment, forced marital sex, a woman beaten up after going to the hairdresser, a 12-year-old girl raped and murdered, a wife humiliated, a wife's imposed isolation from the community, and so on and so on. At this point, the instructor and students, as student assistants, can barely contain the reactions of the group as they mutter to one another, speak out loud, move restlessly in their chairs, cry silently, and raise their hands. It becomes obvious that the theatrical piece on domestic violence has fallen too short to capture participants' experiences. Two students also spontaneously narrate their own personal stories as rape victims in the United States. At this point, everybody starts hugging each other, comforting each other, muttering, etc. No one had ever imagined that Maasai women and the one Maasai man in the workshop would be hugged by the other participants from different ethnic groups, or that the others would allow themselves to be hugged by them, for in this region, correct me if I'm wrong, the Maasai are seen as an ethnic group to be fearful of. No one had foreseen that participants would have to comfort the white American trainers. Age differences, ethnic and racial dynamics, workshop hierarchy, cultural barriers, sex and gender identities have unexpectedly been suspended for emotions to accommodate to the situation. Boundaries are surpassed by affect and affective discourse. A critical wrap-up by the instructor is not necessary for the group to firmly conclude that the pain and outrage held inside their hearts and overflown during the workshop has to do with the negative effects of gender-related prescriptions beyond the domestic sphere. The organizers' expectations for the workshop are amply surpassed. Incipient leaderships for gender issues sprout out of empathy and emotion. Several participants spontaneously commit to working on diverse gender-based violence matters in their communities. The first one to do that was the Maasai man. Cultural and ethnic prejudices around such sensitive issues like ablation, marital or intimate partner forced sex, rape, and so on are overridden through open affective discussions. Barriers among the sexes are blurred, contrary to customary norms. A wide array of intervention and training programs, initiatives, ranging from direct grassroots intervention through mobile health services and related actions to health awareness raising campaigns and training for community health promoters, helped improve diverse aspects of the participants' daily lives. Upon their own request, prior to the workshop session. I have no doubt that all these actions, the programs, fostered trust and receptivity and contributed to the success of the workshop. Nevertheless, these observations by themselves do not provide convincing answers to the following questions. If the workshop participants did not have previous training on gender issues, how come such clear manifestations of gender awareness emerged as deriving from a much larger notion of gender-based violence than posed by the domestic violence theatrical sketch? In other words, why were the participants able to make a connection with unspoken multi-level structural violence to a performance that was very literally just circumscribed to domestic violence? Also, could such manifestations of gender awareness that sprouted during the workshop be channeled into bringing about self and collectively defined sustainable community change on diverse gender issues, including domestic violence? And should they? Well, to begin responding to these questions, I invite you to consider three initial reflections on the outcome of the workshop. One, fully developed critical rational scrutiny on gender norms and values was not necessary to foster personal and collective change because some of the values of each participant were subject to a certain kind of emotional revision or emotional criticism during the workshop. Two, a common ground for collective or intersubjective exchanges on gender issues was forged and was favorable to rekindle painful emotions, allowing for the experiential memory of each participant to surface as emotional feminist criticism. And three, different self-definition skills were enabled and consolidated in various degrees for some participants during the collective affective experience of the workshop, For instance, imagination, introspection, memory, communication, analytical reasoning, volition, interpersonal exchanges, etc. As I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, at the matrix of my analysis of the workshop is a reflection on the epistemological value of affect. Affect as representation and meaning making. In accordance to this assertion, I have structured the last part of my presentation around two core thoughts that apply to the case study example of the workshop. The first thought is about affective discourse. One of the most important aspects of what happened during the workshop is that a sense of personal agency to overcome, fight against, and even manage or endure gender discrimination and manifestations of structural violence emanated during and through the rekindling of emotions. The feminist emotional types of agency and leadership that emerged during the workshop can be said to originate from a personally and socially productive primary capability, to use Martha Nussbaum's metaphor. And this capability is, I believe, feminist emotion. Affect played a major role in fostering leadership. The fact that there was no blueprint, non-normative notions of gender-based violence and women's agency, together with the fact that affective discourse was allowed in a controlled, safe environment, were essential for affect to play such an important role in promoting feminist leadership after the workshop. The latter, affective discourse, for instance, transitorily freed the individual, transitorily meaning during the workshop, freed the individuals and the collective, the group, from social and culturally rooted forms of objection. Remember the reputation that the Maasai had that was totally ignored and overlooked during the dynamics of the workshop. And as a result, all participants became affectively privileged, as opposed to what occurred in the regular life setting. In other words, they all produced valued affective styles without anybody's objection. My second core thought is about the process of self-definition through affect. Clustered emotionality, defined as non-linearly interpretable, entangled patterns of emotions, was activated by a simple participatory method that triggered spontaneous experiences, memory recalling, and thought sharing, a process that autonomy theories would refer to as analogical reasoning. Such clustered emotionality clearly contained knowledge away from and opposed to gender discourses of domination. A method of this sort allowed participants to unleash their own power for self-definition by getting to know feminist emotion in a relational way during the workshop. That is, by listening to themselves in relation to the others and to the others' experiential knowledge in relation to themselves. Let me now pose a few conclusions that will lead to the end of my presentation and perhaps to a productive discussion. The first one, my first conclusion, is that culturally sensitive utterly situated political agendas that include the promotion of gender awareness must pay attention to feminist emotion, because it is very likely to emerge, and if it does, could pave the way for a stronger cognitive awareness of self-defined desired change. In fact, as the workshop study illustrates, case study illustrates, non-reasoning forms of feminism are just awaiting the minimal opportunity to announce themselves. They come in and out of focus and can be inducive of sustainable collective and community change. For instance, the leaderships that emerge now for advocacy in the communities. Instances like storytelling, testimony, or just anecdotic narration of concrete situations, when respected and interpreted as true critical epistemic manifestations of women's situated emotional gender experiences, may be an effective route to foster feminism at multiple levels. As Catriona Mackenzie again has claimed, it is through the narrative of one's experiential memory, the process, which is the process of remembering an event in which emotions associated to that event are also rekindled, that the self is constructed and acknowledged historically, that is contextually, by the very same subject. Thus, a method that includes experiential memory for the aim of underscoring and unleashing the transformational power of feminist emotion may be a forceful tool for feminist programs. By staying put to experience through a spontaneous recalling of instances in which a person identifies her own configuration of emotional criticism, a non-threatening self-revision of the self and circumstances is very likely to take place, non-threatening. What is most interesting to me is that when affect emerges through memory recalling, it is not just about remembering experiences, but about prospect action, both collective and individual. And this is so, let me remind you what I mentioned at the beginning, because the experiences of gender in a patriarchal historical setting leave numerous affective sedimentations in one's emotional life and body. A very important one of these sedimentations is pervasive rebelliousness, primary agency feminist emotion. Furthermore, because emotions are not static, they're neither unchangeable, because there is a non-stickiness, this is proven by neuroscientists now, there is a non-stickiness quality of emotions, true emotions. There is great hope then for this primary agency, feminist emotion, to be channeled into skillful agency. My second conclusion has to do with the non-normative nature of the method used to conduct the workshop. A sense of personal agency emanates through a non-normative method. Again, the absence of a blueprint of what agency is, needless to say autonomy or emancipation, gives way to a strengthened sense of feminist emotion, and thus paves the way to a stronger cognitive awareness of desired changes. The simplicity of the method, like the one used in the workshop, is suitable to the complexity of women's emotional experiences of gender from an intersectional perspective. Subjugation of critical knowledge about the ways in which The self is constrained within normative gender is so pervasive in a patriarchal world and naturalized, so internalized, that it may only emerge as non-threatening type of criticism, emotional criticism, before, much before it emerges as a conscious criticism and someone develops a full feminist consciousness. So an emotional criticism, like the one I just illustrated, is best activated, I believe, as a collaborative process through the type of transitional affiliations like the one provided by the workshop. The group and the setting of the workshop is a transitional affiliation setting. It is possible to affirm that affective discourse shapes the collective sharing and co-imagining, thus allowing for new forms of knowledge about gender and the social surface. The workshop created the right environment for emotional intersubjectivity to develop. That is, it provided the grounds for, in Norman Vincent's terms, quote, a cognitive and emotional alignment of selves in the common field of emotional experience. End of quote. This emotional intersubjectivity thus became the fertile terrain for feminist emotion to be revealed regarding gender-based violence. Even more so, the difficulty of addressing culturally situated notions of the domestic sphere and violence was completely surpassed thanks to the work at the affective level. Put it differently, the cultural variability of emotion and their close relation to values around gender-based violence was examined through collective emotionality. In tune with Uma Narayan, I would say that the participatory method allowed for culture to be left aside as an explanation, but it was culture itself that was being examined through art. Let me recapitulate all that I have said to conclude my presentation and better tie my theoretical framework to the workshop. Participants became attuned to affect and to the specific constituency of rebelliousness that I call feminist emotion through affective discourse, fostered by a participatory method of memory recalling, sharing, and storytelling. Such attunement allowed for gender evaluation beyond cultural barriers and customary norms, to the extent that in some cases, incipient leaderships for community advocacy purposes emerged. There is no doubt to me that feminist emotion was an important aspect of the participants' own lived experiences as interactional individuals in the world, in their world. That is, in the phenomenology of the world. As I mentioned earlier, phenomenological approaches that place the root cause of someone's emotionality in intersubjective relational encounters shed light on how emotionality harbors the cracks of internalized norms through which new definitions of the self and the social can be revealed to the self as agency. This includes certain culturally specific knowledge of transcendentalism, ecology, memory, and so on, that may supplant in some cultures the importance of the self and the individual or together, like postcolonial feminist critics have pointed out. This is precisely why I am claiming that feminist emotion should be recalled for feminist politics and named as such, at least for analytical purposes, whether the promotion of fully rational forms of feminist consciousness is a desirable goal or not. The evidence of affect as truth was the real matter of the workshop. But for such affect to be turned into critical affect about normative gender prescriptions, at least two methodological requirements should be in place. One, affective discourse about gender issues as means to allow the individual to recall specific affective constituencies of their own cluster emotionality and how that has to do with rebelliousness about gender issues. And two, an affective environment. Affective, artificially created, transitory affiliation to allow for free flow of affective discourse. So feminist emotion must be seen as a complementary tool for gender analysis and for feminist politics. I am aware that besides all the stated conclusions, thoughts and observations, there is much more to say about the complicated patterns through which affect manifests, its nuances in the situated realities of the workshop participants, for instance, and many others. I find it useful to think about such complexity through the concept of affective practices, rather than to focus on the nature of affect. And this concept of affective practice is posed forth recently by Margaret Wetherill and other social psychologists. The case study example of the workshop illustrates that the epistemic value of feminist emotion consists precisely on the fact that the possibility of gender awareness is always latent, inscribed in women's bodies through situated individual activity in the social, spatial, physiological, and phenomenological utterances of their experience. It just took a relational disordering of the social through affect in the workshop to awaken gender awareness. It was not created in the workshop, it was there latent, that's my point. It just took that to awaken it. But somehow, gender awareness, like I said, was there already as a sedimented in emotionality for each participant. The interpretative framework that I have outlined reinforces the idea that I initiated this presentation with, that if the rebellious constituencies of affect in one's own emotionality are rendered invisible to her and to others, as it is its tendency, due to the naturalization of gender, a major golden level for politics is disregarded. One thing is clear to me. The sedimented affective practices that have largely passed unnoticed as a form of subversion are women's historical capital that needs to be recovered and fostered. Why? I conclude, because fostering non-reasoning attunements to feminist emotion is about helping the individual, non-male, to come to terms with her unique capacity for rebelliousness, for agency, to overcome and undo the affective canon, if you want, of patriarchal world. Take your comments and clarifications, feedback. Everything is a work in process. This is partly what will be a book eventually. And I am very, very grateful for having the opportunity to share it with you. So I want to know what you think.
Questions? I have a question for the group. I'm recording this. Is everyone okay with that? Like being in it? If you ask questions and things? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Just checking. Okay.
Thank you.
Mine's Patricia.
What is your name again?
Patricia.
Patricia.
I enjoyed the talk very much.
Thank you.
It was very challenging, but worth the challenge. So thank you. My question is simple. Why do you call it feminist emotion and not emotions with an S?
Because it's a component of many emotions.
Okay. So it represents a
The component is a component, it's rebelliousness within many emotions and many other components of emotions. In fact, affect is better. I'm struggling with the term. You know.
Terms are so hard.
So far I'm using this because I depart from a broad definition of emotion. You know, that is maybe better captured as affect. You know. But I don't know. I haven't resolved that question yet. But the singular. Term is because I see it as one component of the so many components that are clustered and entangled in affective life, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it's one, it's rebelliousness.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Rebelliousness is the component. Rebelliousness equals feminist emotion. That's what it is, mm-hmm. in my opinion. You know? And that is part of affect, mm-hmm. and like many other components.
Because it if you put it in singular, it sounds a little essentialist. So like there's an essence, a female essence. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that, but maybe I didn't understand it properly.
Well, I keep that in mind. Yeah. But if I use the plural,
yeah.
then people get confused. And then they think I'm talking about rage, anger, you know, and emotion, many other emotions.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not a great term. I am aware of that. But I really struggle with it. But I purposely put the feminist adjective before that because that is really what captures what it is, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The rebellious aspect of it. If I come up with if you have a better suggestion of another term, I would be happy to think
about it. I don't have a better
too.
Term. But I mean, it's good. I like
yeah.
it. But I was just
But that's why, because people
yeah.
always think that, oh, I feel angry because also told me whatever, or because
mm-hmm.
I don't have the opportunity to do this or that, you know, which is also part of gender experience, you know, all these other emotions.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not that. I am, at first, in my previous research, I was more in that line of thinking, you know, and I was trying to capture those emotions, you know,
mm-hmm.
in literature. And even in contemporary settings, you know, started to think of it, how does it manifest and why does it come up. But the more I deepen in a theoretical, in the theoretical world of affect and emotion, which is huge,
mm-hmm.
incommensurable, the body work is so huge, you know, but there's very recent research that is very exciting. The more I deepen into the trying to polish what it is really that I'm talking about, you know, through these theoretical approaches, the more small it becomes. Small and at the same time, the more important it becomes because it's more everywhere than just what we call traditional devotion.
No, thank you.
It takes a lot of explanation to explain what feminist emotion is, because the first reaction is to think that it's all the emotions, traditionally speaking, that we experience as non-male beings in this world, you know, that it's patriarchal. Takes all this explanation to try to explain what I'm talking about. But I want it to be useful, so I don't want it to be unintelligible. You know, I want people to understand that I'm talking about something that you cannot avoid. It's there, you know. It's there, and it's there in many emotions that come along gender experiences.
Thank you. I really like the talk, because all this feminine emotion is a very new term for me, because I study more about social movement and social science. So if I'm like at a very silly question, ignore me, please. I'm a little bit confused about what do you mean by leadership? Like leadership, because
What I mean by leadership?
Yeah, because I think a lot of how to really create a non-threatening space in a workshop, because I think even though you don't provide blueprint, you provide a performing, and then people could like participate in this performing, like talk about it without being subject to not being put into the subject. But I always worry, like if it's called like affective discourses or skillful agency, would that always be someone is more skillful, someone is more affective, some discourse is more affective, then that creates a difference between who are more ready, who are less. And I always, like when I'm TA, I always worry about silence, even though I prepare very well something for them to talk about, but usually when people refuse, or like, how do you think about like silence as a kind, it's respectful emotion, I think, like you don't want to talk, that's okay, but how being silent, being in this workshop can also help to develop, or could it be possible to develop skillful agency by being silent, or like people like don't want to talk. So I guess it's two questions. One is about whether there's a leadership or whether it's inequality between different skills of agency, or the second question would be like what do you silent as emotion happen in the workshop space. So
I'm not sure I understand what you're asking. The second one is how agency emanates through the workshop.
Yeah, or like how silence. What
how silence?
Silent.
Yes. How silence could be a form of agency. Well, what I was trying to explain is not so much that silence is agency. Is that in silence there is agency through the process of understanding one's own emotionality and being attuned to it. And that, for some people, it may take, you know, being quiet for a long time and being just part of that. For other people, the screaming, you know. But the process is the same, you know, through what I describe as what happened in the workshop, and Araceli Alonso can tell you more about it, but she is the one who was there. I was just struck by what she showed me, you know, like many hours of videotaping of what happened there, and I thought, this cannot be explained unless you explain it through. So it's not that we should, as feminist activists, you know, aim at silence and embrace silence as a form of agency, but we need to be aware that even in silence there is a lot of happening at the emotional level that is rebellious, and that lot happening that is rebellious I call it feminist emotion. So in all the emotions and the experiences of emotional experience that a person that is quiet goes through, in many of those, in this kind of context that is created through a worship like this, there is attunement to that rebelliousness happening, you know, through all these different emotions that she's going through while she's quiet. And all that. And that to me is a form of primary agency that if we only were able to somehow foster and make help women understand that they have that primary agency, they have it. They just have it. They don't need to be full feminists consciously, you know, or call themselves feminists, or they don't even need to call it feminist emotion. Probably not. It's the best thing if they don't call it feminist emotion. But we need to find ways, and that's, you know, part of the work I'm trying to do. This is just somehow the beginning. Trying to think of how we would be, different ways in which it could be fostered, the women's attunement to that primary form of emotion that is theirs, and it's inevitable. It's always there because gender experiences in the world are harsh in many multiple infinite ways and through a multiple array of intersectional factors, you know, of identity, socialization, culture, etc., etc. It's not easy, in other words. Therefore, there are many emotions that come along with that experience, being a non-male person in a patriarchal world. And because that is the case, in all those emotions, there is always a resistance to accept, you know, somehow to accept the norms, or the, but at the subconscious. If we are working only at the more conscious level, fostering feminist consciousness, that's a much longer work. So what I'm saying is that maybe we should focus on this, and we would get even farther, at least reach out more, you know, while the other process of becoming full feminist conscious being happens, if it does and if it should happen, not necessarily, you know. So that's one question, and the other one was about leadership.
I think you explained to me already, because I was just worried about if someone is not skillful enough to articulate or talk about their feeling or their emotion, then it will be silent in the space. I think what you say already answered my question.
So in fact, if you want, there is leadership in feminist emotion. And that what the key is to foster that women are attuned to it.
If I can say something more about the silence and, you know, the manifestation of this rebellion, as you can tell, I do. She theorizes about it. So in the way that, so Teresa is trying to theorize about things that are happening so that we can replicate them in a way, because the ways I do it with knowledge and reflection, but sometimes not as conscious, because I am more practical in the things I do. So Teresa is trying to theorize to see where these sparks of emotion, which you call emotion, feminist emotion, comes from, so that we can replicate it in ways that we are consciously about it. But the manifestation of this rebellion didn't come from the workshop itself for many of the participants. There was a lot of silence, I mean. And you could see, you could almost palpate, you could touch the, which is calling this feminist emotion that I didn't think about when we were doing it. There was a lot of silence there. And there were many participants that they were talking, and but the manifestation of the rebellion came after the workshop, because it's when the participants became committed across religious boundaries, across gender boundaries, because there were men and women, across ethnic animosities, across everything that you can imagine. It became very, very tangible because they started working together and performing for the rest of the communities, doing skits for domestic violence. And that was a taboo issue just before the workshop. So that was, but there was a lot of silence. Mm-hmm. And there's always, and I totally understand when in a class or within a discussion, am I not a good leader? Am I not eliciting? Well, no, I think what Teresa is saying is there, although the outsider cannot really, cannot observe it well, but it's there. It was there in this case, and she's trying to theorize about why it was there.
What I am doing is naming something that is there, really. I'm not making up anything. I'm not inventing, you know, illuminating, you know, concept. No, I am giving a name to something that exists everywhere. Even in literature of the 17th century, everywhere. It's just a matter of having an analytical tool first, and hopefully this analytical tool will help also as a pragmatic tool for intervention, you know, and action-oriented programs. We'll see.
Yeah. I'm thinking a little bit about what it does to your concept that it's so tied to what you call non-male persons, and the experience of living as a non-male person in a patriarchal society and so on. And when you then also said, well, there were men too, and they were reacting too.
We should discuss that
here. I wonder if it ties it in a place where it doesn't necessarily need to be. And I'm also a little, I have maybe it's just because it's so new to me, but I have a hard time figuring out exactly what this is. So you talked about boundaries between people in the workshop being broken down by affect and then through affect and through affective discourse. Mm-hmm. You separated the two from each other. Mm-hmm. And then one question I have is, what is the difference between affect and affective discourse? But also, what is affect? Like, if you could just say it with a few words, you call it emotion, feminist emotion, and in the beginning you separated affect and emotion and a third thing, I can't remember what it was. So feeling was personal, emotion was social, and affect was
pre-personal. Yeah, that's a theory.
But you brought it up as sort of a distinction to pay attention to. But then in the presentation, you switched some between emotion and affect, and then you asked us to pay attention to these three questions about how affect circulated, how it materialized or solidified, I think you called it, and then how it related to these personal stories. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, I was listening for the answer to that, like,
didn't provide any answer.
And then I was wondering, was it because I didn't hear it, or could you just say a little bit about how it is tied to these personal stories? I know it's a lot of questions, but I wonder if you could just get a little closer to what it is, and if it is tied to only female-bodied people, how does it then work in the workshop that there are also male-bodied people, and you're talking about domestic violence and things that I think it would be very helpful to include many people in, and not just female-bodied people. But,
Okay, let me start with the first thing, or the last thing, actually. Yes, as all of you who have knowledge of feminist theory, have been working on feminist issues for a long time, know it's better now at this point. We are in a position to talk about gender instead of women, you know, versus men, etc. But I shifted, you know, to mentioning women, or trying to include, you know, a broader category, non-male beings, you know, because I depart from the assumption that most women, not men, okay, let me just talk about these two, the distinction first, because women, as opposed to men, if we depart only from this bisexual division, experience gender in the world in a very negative way, you know, in many, many, many multiple forms. It's not the same to have a female body or to be constructed as a female, you know, in this world, than to be perceived and constructed and identified as a man. Okay? So, I wanted to include other non-male beings, you know, not just women, you know, for you to blink an eye to you and let you know that I am constructing my own theoretical premises from a gender approach. But the fact that there was a man in the workshop and that he was the first one to volunteer as a leader, what drove that person, and maybe Anatoly has a different opinion, but I believe that what drove this man to stand up and say, I want to defend women from the gender-based violence in my community, and I'm going to do work on that ever since, you know, from now on. What drove him to take that stand is very different, in my opinion, to what drove the women, the 20 women that were in the workshop, to struggle through all the emotional turmoil that the sharing of experiences related to gender-based violence provoked. It's very different. You know? One thing is awakening the consciousness of men that is not just what's happening to women. And another thing is to struggle at the deep emotional level that what has happened to you or to other women, and you see yourself in the skin of the other woman, because it happens to you in different ways, but it does happen. We live, women in a patriarchal world, experience infinite, multiple ways and diverse ways of and types of violence, starting from language and beginning from rape, if you want, or murder, or stoning, or whatever, you know? It's humongous, the array of violence that we endure as non-male beings in the world. That is very different, you know? It doesn't mean that we do not need to incorporate men in the workshop. Of course, we need many more Maasai men like him, you know? Or men from other ethnic groups to become also advocates for women's rights. Of course we do. But what happened to him is very different than what happened to him in the workshop, at the level of affect, kind of. None of that asks to a question. And then, you have many other questions. The shift from affect and emotion. Again, the concept and the terms. There is not, from what I have read lately, and the most recent research that I have read from the social sciences and humanities on affect and emotion, there is not an agreement on what emotion is or what affect is. I don't subscribe completely to affect theorist division, you know, because I think, well, I explain it, you know, but I believe that what affect theory proposed is very exciting and is very stimulating intellectually, you know, and they do very interesting, I don't know if you're familiar with this criticism, they do very interesting cultural studies criticism, you know, very interesting, that to speak about social subversion, for instance, you know, there are multiple ways, you know, through cyber bodies and through the media and through images and through parts of the body that appear here and there and through many different, they do really interesting analysis on how there is more to emotions and affect than what we traditionally think of the starting or rooted at the individual level. You know? There is more that escapes control, if you want, in this power dynamics of the social and cultural environments that we are examining. But what happens when what I want to say is that is very, it opens a new dimension of analysis and reflection, that there is much more there that escapes control of power, you know, dynamics and power structures and power institutions. And that's very exciting, you know. It's slippery, it's constant, it's flowing, it's dynamic, it's everywhere. There are many subversive manifestations of affect, according to affect theories, everywhere. Okay. That's great, but women have affect inscribed in their bodies, mm-hmm. at the individual level too. And so I think for feminist political purposes, we need to go back to the individual, but not in the traditional positivistic way, but to the individual in a relational way too, and to the individual as the affective, elusive
way. That's why I'm focusing on it in a very broad sense. So that's why I shifted, you know, to try to explain this, you know, make that clarify more or less. Is there anything?
Hi, my name is Georgia, and Georgia, like the state.
Yeah.
first, I want to apologize for being late. I'm from out of town, and I'm in parking spaces. Forget it. Anyway, a couple of things. First of all, an observation, and it's not even that much of an observation, and go, oh yeah, of course. Focusing on emotion is a rebellious act in and of itself.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, absolutely. Focusing on
the value of emotion.
On non-male, well, let me say, non-cisgender male emotions is an even bigger step in rebellion. And that is to say, these things are important. These feelings are important. And a lot of the reasons we have this experience of with our bodies of not being recognized, not being acknowledged, not being empowered, is precisely because it's emotion and then it's women's emotions. Mm-hmm. And so this is a rebellious act in itself. I'm writing my own memoir, dealing with violence issues, among other things. And I know that there has been a huge movement in memoir writing, and women in particular. And then there's all this storytelling going on with respect to, this is one of our ways of healing, is to tell our stories. And this is an individual act of agency and rebellion. And then when you get to the aftermath, it's a lot more emotions involved then. Okay. But what I want to ask is, how do we translate this into collective political?
That's what we're working on.
Yeah. Because it's the you have to start with that individual personal recognition, always personal is political, but it can't stop there. Okay. Other observation is, when you think about it, all effective political action begins with emotion. Nobody commits time and energy. Nobody goes and sits on in a protest and risks getting beaten by police unless there's a foundation of emotion. So I think what you are doing is absolutely critical. And
thanks for sharing your thoughts too.
They were here in the morning.
Oh, okay.
We can talk afterwards because there is
the
master pieces, but we can just leave this.
We can go to
my office.
Yeah, go. Well, yeah, yes.
I got a table.